Good morning and welcome to Business Africa Live on BTA. I'm your host, Benjamin Afre. This morning, we'll be taking a look at some business economic issues in Ghana, in Nigeria, Kenya, and Zambia. We'll take a short break. When we come back, I'll introduce my guests for our discussion this morning, and we'll take our discussions from there. Welcome back. We had a former governor of the Bank of Ghana, deputy governor of the Bank of Ghana, Dr. Mahmoud Bawumia, giving a lecture on the state of the economy. And one of the things that he said was that the economy is in crisis. Ghana's economy is in crisis. And gave some, you know, prognosis of what could be happening to the economy, the weak fundamentals, the exchange rate depreciation, and all that. Through this discussion and the rest with me is Benjamin Acker, a stockbroker, an analyst from HFC Stockbrokers. And then Charles Amwakwata from Carl Brokers, and also an analyst and a stockbroker as well. Welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Good to have you on our show. So is Ghana's economy in crisis, as Dr. Bawumia said during his lecture? Is it in crisis? Would you agree with that comment that he made? Charles, you can take.
I think the description crisis is a matter of subjectivity. Okay, so I would not like to go into whether it is in crisis by using that word to describe it, because after the lecture, I've also listened to a couple of economists who also say that we have problems. They don't call it crisis, but they say they are challenges. Okay, so I wouldn't like to go to the description of the situation, but I will look at the problems that he actually enumerated, whether these are real problems that we are facing as a country. And on that basis, I would do agree with him, because if you want to assess the performance of every economy, there are internationally acceptable standards that you can use, okay? And he actually enumerated them, and these are actually rare. Mm-hmm. Okay, the twin deficit problem, mm-hmm. budget deficit and current deficit.
It's a problem.
Current account deficit is a problem we are facing. The depreciation of the cedi against the major currencies, the dollarization of the economy. We are having energy crisis, energy problem. Since last 2 years, last year and this year, we have an energy problem. If you also look at our GDP growth target, mm-hmm. we've not been able to achieve that. Okay. So at the end of the day, you realize that these are challenges that we are facing as a country. They are reality, and I do agree with him that they are real, and we need to find a way of addressing them. So for me, I think that these are problems that we are facing. The description has to do with the politicians. They can find any ways to describe them. Some say it is a crisis. Others say it's a challenge. Others say it's a problem. I think it's a problem that we are facing, and we need to put our heads together to see how best we can deal with them.
You also think so? It's just you are not in crisis.
I am disinclined to use the word crisis. I think, like you said, it's a matter of subjectivity. The person who is looking at the data will determine whether it's a crisis or not. Like you said, politicians tend to use a lot of words, so I'm not so inclined to use it. But yes, there are challenges. The weak fundamentals, like he pointed out, the budget deficit, current account deficits, those are real issues. So it's, we have to tackle these issues head on, because as a country, we need to move forward. And challenges, crisis, and also, I won't go down that line.
Why? Look, we've moved from a single-digit inflation that had run for almost 3 years consistently to now doing double digits. Our interest rates have gone up. Just recently, the Bank of Ghana had to show up the interest rates, move it to about 28 to increase the prime rate. And that has also had its own effects on the treasury bill rates, going up to as high as 23 as I speak with you. You have situations where we are energy, you know, is a serious issue now. Industries are complaining. From last year, you saw some of the performance of the listed, some of the listed equities, especially those in manufacturing. Most of their costs had come to do with energy. So wouldn't you then put a country in such a situation as in a crisis situation?
Challenged. The economy challenged. Is challenged.
But not in crisis.
Crisis is a strong word to describe a situation that has not actually brought you to your knees. I wouldn't go as far as saying crisis. Yes, there are problems with the economy. There are situations that have arisen as a result of probably the management of the economy itself. But I think that the government has come out to say that they are working on these things. Some of these things are not quite new. The depreciation of the cedi is not exactly a new thing.
Statutory payments, for example, have been in arrears for a while. Some have been arrears since June of last year.
But
those are statutory payments. You know, so, well, like, but like you said, everybody will probably want to look at it from a different angle. Is the cup half full or half empty?
Precisely.
Possibly that is where you're coming from.
It's a question of subjectivity.
Of subjectivity.
How do I describe a situation that I have looked into? Dr. Bamia has looked into it. He determines, based on what he has, the data that he has and what he has said, and how he looks into these things, and saying that it's a crisis.
It's a crisis situation.
That is his opinion. It's difficult for us to come to a compromise on this and say that everybody will agree that it's a crisis. But that is what he thinks, because he has looked at the figures.
I think one comment that he made was that once you accept the fact that, in quotes, the economy is in crisis, then you can pull people along to help you stabilize the economy. But if you refuse to see it as in a crisis situation, and therefore you tend to paint a picture that, oh, this is a short-term measure or a short-term situation, and it will go away, and it doesn't, then you'd have done yourself in, because you might not have been able to pull the people along with you.
But you see, a lot of the economy, large parts of the economy, depends on confidence of investors in what you are doing.
Okay.
Painting a picture of the economy is in crisis, wouldn't that amount to people trying to move their funds out of this country and going elsewhere and creating a panic situation? You don't want to get into a position where there is panic all around. People are not sure what is going to happen because you are seeing that the economy is in crisis. That's a danger.
Aren't we already seeing these effects? Just about this week, government, for example, had decided to suspend its decision to buy to borrow more from the euro market, the euro bond, because of the fear that you would have not a single digit interest rate, but possibly a double digit interest rate on those loans. Wouldn't you then look at it that if an outsider or if the government is thinking that way, then it's possible that already people outside this country are looking at that situation?
But just look at the effects that actually seeing it in crisis will actually make.
You rather you don't say it, even though
I would rather you tackle the issue
head on.
Go according to your principles, try and sort out the problems that the challenges that have arisen, and try and solve them. Seek a broad
based solution to the problems,
and bring people on board and try and find solutions to this problem. But declaring that you're in a crisis, I just think that in such a situation, there will be panic all around. Panic all around. Funds will probably not come. Those that are already in will start moving elsewhere, seeking safe areas, because that's the thing.
But we still have the political stability, so possibly that should count for something.
It should count for something, shouldn't it?
Yeah. Well,
Dr. Baumia also urges the Bank of Ghana to reverse the recent foreign exchange measures they put in place. He doesn't believe that those measures in itself will be able to solve the problem, because he doesn't think that it is the dollarization of the economy that is causing the problem, but rather confidence of people in the economy and in the value of the cedi, which is the currency of Ghana, that is causing all these fluctuations and all this depreciation. Wouldn't you agree with that assertion?
I think I do agree to some extent. Okay. And I must say that already the Bank of Ghana has come out to say that they need to review
some of the measures
mm-hmm. because after a month of its application, they have actually done their own assessment, and then they've seen the areas where they are making good impact and the mm-hmm. areas that are not really working.
Mm-hmm.
So for him to say it, I think he's only adding his voice to it. The IMF has also said it, that they should also review it. Okay. So the fact that the Bank of Ghana themselves, okay, have come out to say that they want to review it means that some of them are not working
the way they really anticipated
you know, to be. And I think that some of them are counterproductive, you understand, because if you come out with such policies, you actually discourage people from bringing
the dollar into the country. Economy.
Exactly. And even if they bring the dollars into the country, what happens? They will not take it to the bank.
Mm-hmm.
Because the policy is that if you bring dollar to the country,
you can't take it back.
You can't take it back.
In the dollar.
It has to be converted to cedis. You understand? Mm. So even when people even bring the money, they prefer to keep it. Or they'll trade in it at the outside the banking system.
Yeah, black market.
Yeah, and by so doing, you are starving the company of dollars. You understand? So I do agree that that aspect need to be done, and you and I agree that Zambia, for example,
mm-hmm.
had a similar policy in place, and after 2 years of operation, they have realized that it's counterproductive. So just last week, the government decided to actually scrap it, and indications are that after they've scrapped it, the Kwachan has begun to recover, to record some gains, which means that people are now bringing in the dollars into the country, because they know that when they bring it,
they'll be able to take their money back.
Anytime they want it, they'll be able to take it back.
So would you then say that possibly the Bank of Ghana was maybe rushed into the decision? Was it a panic, a knee-jerk reaction then? Because if after just about a month or so, they're going back to revise some of those decisions, then it seems to me it wasn't a thoroughly thought-through process or decision to come out and say that.
With every policy that you put in place, you need to give it some time.
Mm-hmm.
At the beginning of the process, there might be some adjustment processes that go on. But I wouldn't say they rush into it. After you put in these policies, you do a review of what you have done.
Mm-hmm.
They have done the review and they come to some conclusions. But I wouldn't say that they have rushed into it just because it's not exactly working out the way they expected it to work out. But with everything that you put in place, you do a review. Mm-hmm. If you assess it and it's going well, you leave it as it is. If some aspects are not going well, you modify the places that are not going
too well. So that is why I'm asking that possibly, that if you look at some of the aspects, maybe if they had done a little bit more, thinking through some of those things, or if they had done a bit more of some education before its introduction, there may not have been the need to revise it now, because it's just about a month or two. It's not really that long. You understand? That is where my challenge is coming from.
Well, they needed to stem the fall in the city.
But it hasn't entirely stopped. It's still depreciation, maybe at a slower pace.
Yes.
But hasn't entirely stopped.
But the thing is that when you put in these measures, do you expect that immediately?
Mm-hmm.
Do you expect that immediately?
Yeah.
The results will be known. The things will change all of a sudden. Mm-hmm. No, there will be a process of adjustment.
Okay.
Even there will be a situation where people who are affected by these policies will try and even go more after the dollar, looking for more of the dollar to keep it at a store of value, creating a certain level of panic situation. I wouldn't say they rushed into it, But I would say that after you put in a policy, you do a review.
Mm.
If after doing your review, you think it's going well, you leave it as it is.
Let me give you an example. You had the situation where the mortgage companies, for example, charge charge in dollar, right? So if I take a mortgage and I'm supposed to pay $300 a month, and I'm not supposed to pay in dollar, but in the CD equivalent. What happens is that whatever rate is quoted is in the mind of the mortgage company. You see, so they can even on their own keep increasing the rates to the detriment of people. So that's where I'm coming from, that if you look at it that way, then it will seem as if we rush into a decision. Because the fact that today the rate is, say, 2.6 to the dollar, and you ask me to stop quoting in the dollar, doesn't mean that
no,
I am not going to use the dollar
like
as a base.
He's not
quote.
Thinking in dollars.
Yeah, like you said, I'm thinking dollar, but talking to you in cedis. Exactly. So that's what I'm saying, that possibly, maybe going forward, we need to take a look at some of these things, that it even going to be a revision. Maybe they should also think through a bit more before they even come up with that.
I think, the way and the manner the policies came, you can see that there was some aspect of rush. Okay, because all of a sudden, we heard that he came up with the policy. The policies were there already, so they activated them.
Mm-hmm.
And they said, henceforth, this and this and this are supposed to be done.
Beginning from the day that they made the announcement.
Exactly. and you realize that there was a public kind of, some kind of opposition.
Mm-hmm.
Because it looked like there wasn't enough consultation. Okay, and people who already have a dollar account with banks, and anytime they go to banks, they're able to get the dollar back. As soon as the policy came, it took retrospective effect. And there were even legal aspects that if you come out with a new policy, okay, it shouldn't take retrospective effect. Those who are already
in the system
before the policy came, you should allow them to be able to withdraw in dollars. But those who are now bringing in dollars, then the police can really apply to them. Okay.
So
afterwards you realize that there was a lot of education and then explanation and a lot more publications that they want to clarify
some of the issues.
People have not really understood it well. So you realize that there was an attempt to immediately bring down the situation. But in its attempt to bring down the situation, it rather created a lot of panic.
You understand?
So there was some aspect to me, as far as I'm concerned, because of the reaction that really came, after the policies were actually published and then introduced. If you look at the public reaction, you realize that there was some, rush. If they had taken their time to do some consultations,
maybe
they wouldn't have actually done some of these things.
But can you imagine what would have happened if the Bank of Ghana had said that from next week we are going to impose this foreign exchange?
You think there still have been a panic?
There will be a rush
to go and take their
money out. Take it. I think that it would just have created a situation of confusion all around.
Mm.
I think that because from what I heard, they consulted the banks who were going to implement these things.
Mm-hmm.
But in respect of those who were actually going to use the dollars, they couldn't tell them. Because they didn't want to create a situation where there will be a mad rush for the dollar.
But let me ask, how many people really in the banking industry really have dollar accounts and really with very significant holdings? Maybe just a few people.
I wouldn't have the few
already people. Almost 70% of the population is unbanked. You understand? So that is where I'm coming from, that possibly they could have either done some targeted education.
Exactly.
Because definitely already we know those who have the dollar. If you go to any bank, you are the regulator. The bank will be able to tell you which and which people have. And maybe we could have done some targeted education, not to scare them off, but to explain to them and maybe give them some assurance. But going forward, I'm hoping that we don't find ourselves in similar situation. One thing that Dr. Bahamia, though, said was that he doesn't think that the dollarization is the issue. In terms of the dollarization of the economy, and the example I give is if you go to Zambia, they had similar situation where they imposed certain restrictions if you are going to do transactions in dollar and all that, you needed to report to the Bank of Zambia and all that. Now, about last week, they decided to scrap those laws. And all of a sudden, for 3 days continuous, the Kwacha has been on the ascendancy against the dollar. So if you look at it in that regard, wouldn't you then agree with the assertion that Dr. Bawumia says that it is not really the dollarization, but the fundamentals of the economy?
I think it's a bit too early to judge the Zambian situation because it just took effect just a bit last week. But yes, from early indications are that some funds have come in from abroad because of the confidence that this measures have brought back into the system. But I still think it's a bit too early to judge on that. Because before these measures were put in place, there was a situation where their Kwacha was depreciating. That's why they had to bring in some of these measures.
Mm-hmm.
So I will give it some time, see how it plays out before I can comment on that one. But with respect to dollarization of Ghana's economy, yeah, it is not exactly the cause. The primary cause, of course, are the weak fundamentals, the budget deficit, all these things that we've talked about. But dollarization can also be seen as a secondary cause. Because once the main effect kicks in, and people are looking for dollar all over the place as a store of value, it accelerates the rates.
There could be a symptom rather off.
Precisely. The main cause being the weak fundamentals.
And then triggering.
Triggering the dollarization.
I see. Well, let's take a look at Nigeria's market. If you look at the stock market, there's quarter one 2014. You have a lot of the consumer goods sector reporting, you know, earnings, very weak earnings. And most of it is attributed to the fact that if you look at the northern part of Nigeria, because of the situation with Boko Haram, distribution has become a problem because nobody really wants to venture and go out there. You know, looking at what is happening in quarter one and the weakening security situation up north, do you foresee this trend continuing?
I think I read the report, okay. And, the report has actually attributed about three reasons why they believe that the quarter one results will not be impressive.
Yeah.
And they have listed this security issue, the Boko Haram, which actually hamper the distribution of their products. Okay.
Mm.
And then the fact that some of the raw material they use for production are also going up, so it affects cost of production.
Yeah.
And then the last thing has to do with the fact that seasonally, normally, first quarter
yes.
You know, demand is very low,
yeah.
You understand? So these are the factors. And I think that as long as the first quarter is a seasonal problem,
mm-hmm.
definitely to affect them because it's a seasonal problem.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and then with the Boko Haram issue, it has been with Nigeria for some time now. And it's one of the security threats that they are really fighting with that they've not been able to succeed yet. They might have succeeded to some extent by bringing it down,
mm-hmm.
but it is still an issue that they need to battle with going forward. So I do agree with the research report, given the factors that are likely to impact on the performance of the fast moving consumer sector. So maybe I think for the first quarter, but I believe that once the first quarter is over, and then the lean season is also over, and the managers of the economy try to put things in order. To see to it that they also bring inflation down, I believe that maybe things will pick up.
Do you also think so?
Well, I sort of have a very slightly different thing. Boko Haram has been with the Nigerians for quite a while now, even last year.
Yeah.
But then the companies churned out very, very impressive results.
That's true.
In spite of the fact that Boko Haram was raging in the Northeast.
That's true.
So I will not be so quick as to ascribe their weak earnings to the Boko Haram issue because evidence suggests that it didn't affect them too much, last year. However, with respect to the seasonality of it, yes, I do agree. Demand sort of lowers down in the first quarter as a result of the Yuletide. Consumers sort of want to hold on a bit to their funds. So I tend to agree with that one. But with the Boko Haram issue, they are doing quite well, at least as evidence from the results of last year.
You don't think, for example, the fact that it is hampering the distribution of produce or products of these companies
Because the northern regions seem to have quite a very good population as well.
Well, distribution, there will be a problem. But I think that somehow...
The effect will not be that big?
The effect will not be that big because the companies have found a way around it.
Okay.
Because I am just looking at the evidence of last year's result, first quarter, second quarter, third quarter, fourth quarter, from the Nigerian companies.
Okay.
And realizing that they made impressive results.
Yeah.
So they must have found a way
around
the Boko Haram problem. That's what I think.
Still in Nigeria, you know, currently China is experiencing very slow growth. And Nigeria seems to also have very good relationship with China in terms of trade. Now, with China's slowing growth, there is the potential to affect Nigeria because it looks like they are doing very significant business with them. Now, if that is going to happen, that is, if it is going to happen at all, do you foresee any serious impact on Nigeria's economy?
Nigeria's economy, there will be some impacts. Because if the China imports a lot of raw materials, of their raw materials from Nigeria, as well as most African nations, their growth is slowing down, which means that the volumes that they probably require will lower, which means that the export earnings that these African companies will earn will lower. But ultimately, the growth and management of an economy depends solely on the individuals and the managers of that economy. So it is up to them to find a way around this declining
diversify
into other areas, look at other ways of handling the economy so that they will not be too affected. There will be some impact because if a lot of your earnings are coming from a particular source and that stocks slow down, there will be some impact.
Yes, definitely.
But the economy of Nigeria should be up to the Nigerians and how they handle it.
This brings my mind back to some of the discussions that we've had in terms of trade, you know, among ourselves. This is Nigeria.
Yeah.
But as you rightly said, China imports not only from Nigeria, but a lot of us as well. If you take, we are giving them a lot of crude, for example, and all that. It looks to me that if we continue to depend on countries like China alone, maybe US or the Europeans, neglecting our own sub-region, our own continent, we would be in some very dire straits then.
Yes, I do agree. If you look at most of our economies, you know, in this part of the world, we realize that we really depend on most of these companies and most of these countries.
Yeah.
And the trading has not actually been in our favor. We don't really have a competitive advantage when it comes to international trade because we intend to import raw-based materials, no value addition. And then secondly, we also import a lot of things from them. So if you look at our balance of trade, it's always in deficit. Okay. So Africa, you know, in recent times has become a very good partner, you know, to China. And there are a lot of Chinese investment in Africa, you know, from Nigeria to Angola to South Africa, you know, to Ghana and then to Sudan. And there are a lot of foreign aid, and these are all strategies by, you know, China to make sure that they get the best, you know, out of Africa. So I think we need to move beyond dependency to interdependency, okay, where, you know, all of us will depend on each other. But not, it should not be one way, you know, affair where one person, one country entirely depends on the other country, so that when the other country decides to really draw back, then you find yourself not wanting. You should be, you know, in a position to really interdepend on each other rather than making it, you know, depending or making it one way, you know, kind of affair.
I see. Well, still in Nigeria, there is a proposal to increase the bank's cash reserve ratio from 75 to 100%. What is going to be the effect of this? One, on the banks, maybe their profitability, but more also in terms of the private sector. What is this going to, what impact will this have on them?
Well, cash reserve ratio is, I don't believe it's the amount of funds of the public sector that the banks are mandated to keep with the central bank. what has been available to them is given out as loans to their clients and all this. So it provides additional source of funding into the economy. Sort of keeps the funds away, the amount of funds that is available to unlend to consumer. What that happens is that cost of capital then is driven up because you are no longer getting the cheap source of funds as you were getting. Cost of capital interest rate rises. Cost of doing business generally then will rise. That is one way of looking at it. But you could also argue that bringing all these funds away from the banks will sort of create a situation where the banks then have to be forced to do business, so to speak.
Like to look for business.
Look for business. Look
chase
for
customers.
Exactly, because currently, because the funds are low, the banks may not be willing to go into risky areas. Because the funds are quite low, you can give it to a person who his risk is very low, and you make some funds. But then, if you are forced to actually put it in areas where you make some funds, because for example, if this money is not available to you, what you have to do then is to go to private investors to go and raise some funds to be able to unlend it out. Those ones don't come cheap.
Exactly.
But so that you would have to give it out to areas where you get even more rates than what you are receiving for it. So it's you can look at two sides of it, where it sort of increases cost of capital all that, but then it forces the banks to actually go into areas such as maybe agriculture, which is probably risky, but then not many people want to go there. But then the returns will be high if you're able to manage your risk very, very well, or other areas such as that, so that you make good money.
And for your
investors.
You know, one of the reasons why they are doing this is to bring some stability to the exchange rates.
Yeah.
You know, if you listen to the managing director for First Bank, for example, he thinks it is a psychological thing, and doesn't see why, or he thinks Nigeria should decide between taking that decision to increase the cash reserve ratio or giving the banks that leverage to be able to lend to the private sector.
This is a policy issue, so it depends on the policy direction of the central bank. Okay, because when you talk about cash reserve ratio, you talk about the monetary policy rate. These are all tools that central banks use to control or ensure that there's price stability in the economy. So, is it about price stability or it's about growth? Or it's about both? So, anytime central bank or managers of an economy sit down to review an economy, they try to find out what do we want to achieve. Do we want to achieve price stability? Do we want to encourage growth, or do we want to do both? If you want to do both, we have to then strike a balance. Exactly. So from the way things have been going in Nigeria, you realize that there's a pressure on the naira, and for that reason the naira has depreciated against the dollar this year. Some depreciation. They have actually depleted their foreign exchange reserve. It has come down to, I think, the lowest in recent times, about $37 billion for now.
Yeah.
There is also inflation on the rise. So looking at this trend, what should be the policy direction of the central bank to ensure price stability? So what you do is that you try to, withdraw money.
Take some more money
from the system. Okay. So you don't actually allow banks to give out more money. So whoever brings money to the bank, whether private or public, you try to really reduce or limit the amount of money that the banks can give out, so that more money will not go into the system to lead to inflation, to also put pressure on the naira. So I think that the policy direction of the central bank and the government is to, at the moment, bring about price stability, and at the same time also ensure that companies will also have access to, cheap money, so that they can also, bring about some growth.
The difficulty I have is that, good as it may be to want to stabilize the exchange rates, if you're not careful, you also starve the real sector from real cash or real investments. Because if you're reducing how much the banks can unlend to the private sector, then, like Ben was saying, there is a tendency for interest rates to go up. Because whatever that I have, then there is a need to make maximum out of it. That is what I think. I don't know if you
yeah, but they always have to strike a balance. Okay, every policy, you know, you implement, it has positive effect and negative effect. There's no policy that you implement that will only give you one side effect. But at the end of the day, what you have to do is that you need to strike a balance. Okay, to make sure that the gains
far outweigh exactly the negatives.
So that is why the bank decided that the policy rate should be maintained at 12%. Okay, they just ended their monetary policy meeting, and they actually maintained it at 12%, because if they should increase it, interest rates will also go up, and banks will actually or companies will find it expensive really getting money. So they decided to maintain the policy rate, and at the same time also try to deal with the issue of price instability. Because if you live in a country where price is not stable, currency is always depreciating, prices are going up, it becomes difficult for businesses to actually forecast or to predict properly. Or to plan properly.
Yeah.
You understand? So yeah. It should be a balanced. You understand? So I believe that looking at the current challenge that they are facing, I believe that after price stability has been achieved,
maybe they can reduce
exactly,
it.
Exactly. Then they will look at the growth aspect. You understand, to make sure that things are really, in place.
Yes, add to that, let's not forget that next year is an election year in Nigeria.
Well,
and in election years, somehow in Africa,
the figures are important. Yeah.
There are a lot of fans all over the place. So it may be a way to curb all these excesses that may be there.
I see. Well, viewers, we'll take a short break. We'll be right back. Welcome back. So, Ben, just a quick comment on the Kwacha's gain against the dollar. Like we said earlier, they had scrapped those policies that banned the use of the dollar in their economy. And it seemed that banning those policies seemed to have spurred the Kwacha on, so that for a 3-day running, you have it gaining against the dollar. What do you think, this is sustainable?
You know, frankly, I have an issue with using dollar in Zambia and not Kwacha. If I want to go and buy goods and services, I should be able to buy it in Kwacha.
And
why should I be buying in dollars? We should be able to do other transactions in dollar, but going to buy things, I think it should be in Kwacha. But having said that, they have reversed it. I think it's a bit short to do a proper review of how it is working, because it's... like you said, as Kwacha has been appreciating for quite a bit now because of this reversal. But I still think it's too early to pass a judgment on how they have affected it.
Would you possibly attribute this to, there's been a bit of steady in the price of copper.
Yeah.
It had also been on some, fall for a while. But Monday, for example, the price was stable. Do you think that price stability in copper, their major export item, will probably also have this effect that they are currently witnessing?
Yes, I think it is possible that it also have a positive effect, okay, on the currency, because when you are dealing with the issue of depreciation of a currency, it is not only one solution.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, the problem might have been contributed by a number of issues. So you have to tackle it from different angles. You don't have to only use one policy option to try to address it. Okay. So I believe that the issue of scrapping this policy, which has started yielding positive results, is good.
Okay, but other policy options should also be looked at
to support
it, to make it more sustainable. And as you just said, you know, the copper has actually lost value this year, and it's a major revenue, you know, to Zambia. But my information is that it is almost at the bottom. Okay, so it's likely that it will begin to, you know, record some.
Copper has started going up for the past 3 weeks. It was on decline,
exactly.
But it has been stable since Monday. It went up yesterday, up a little bit. So maybe it is beginning to look up again, and that could probably be giving the Kwacha a bit more strength.
Exactly. So once the price goes up, what it means is that they are going to get, you know, they are going to get more, you know, revenue. And then their foreign exchange reserve position, foreign reserve position is going to improve. And once it improves, definitely it will support the local currency. So I think different policy options should be looked at to try to address the challenges that they are facing within the economy. They should not only rely on one policy option.
Windfall tax on mining companies. Ghana has battled with its own. It was introduced, but for some reason, it was held back because the mining companies were complaining that the burden is too much. Now, Zambia is looking to reintroduce the windfall tax. This was a campaign promise by the government, and so it's looking to reintroduce it. Do you think maybe for them it might be the right time to introduce that?
Right time, I'm not so sure, because copper prices have been falling. Windfall tax, if you were going to make significant gains on it, you should have taking it at a point when the copper price was so high. So probably it's a bit late in the day, but I guess it's never late, better late than ever. I think with windfall tax, it provides some amount of revenue to the economy, to the government, to be able to pursue its agenda. I don't think it's a bad thing on its own. I'm not sure whether the mining companies have actually said they don't want it. It's just I think that they have issues with how it's going to be administered. So I don't know about the Zambian situation too much, but I think that they could have brought this thing on at a time when the prices of copper were very, very, very high.
So possibly
high.
Maybe the time might not be, that's true. Right.
I mean, I think it's the timing. Okay, so I look at it in two ways.
Mm-hmm.
One, you ask the question whether is it good. I mean, any policy, okay, that will seek to bring more revenue to government is a good policy.
Mm-hmm.
Because we have a problem of revenue collection. We don't meet our taxes.
Okay.
So there should be new ways to really make sure that we improve on our revenue. So windfall tax is one of the ways every government can look at to increase their revenue. We understand. But the issue is the time of its implementation. It might be a right policy, but if we don't implement it at the right time, okay, the reaction will actually be very negative. So I agree with the principle that the timing, because there's this perception. I mean, there are certain things that companies or individuals find it difficult doing. People don't naturally want to pay tax.
Mm-hmm.
Companies don't naturally want to pay tax, even if they make super abnormal profit.
You want to pay tax.
Exactly. Just as an individual don't want to pay tight. So making some of these payments are very difficult. So even if multinational companies are making abnormal taxes, voluntarily, they will not decide to pay more tax to the government.
Mm-hmm.
So it's up to the government to actually try to convince them and persuade them and come up with, also look at strategies to make sure that you also get best out of them. But it should be done at the right time. You do it when prices of commodities have gone up.
Mm.
And everybody knows that prices of commodities have gone up. They are making super abnormal profit. So if we ask them to pay, then they don't have any other option.
Yeah, it might not be too difficult to pay.
But when commodity prices are down,
they
are thinking of downsizing and restructuring. And you are going to bring this issue. Definitely, it's not the right time. And I think that is why in our own case, the president recently said that they need to suspend it, and then maybe they will have to relook it at another time, because conditions pertaining within the mining sector and the industry with regard to the pricing of commodities and then the issue of downsizing and then how cost of production will not be actually augur well for them if they should actually add this to the mining company. So it is a good way of raising revenue, but the timing should be considered.
I see. Well, finally, let's take a look at Kenya. You know, the economy has had some serious challenges. And then what the National Treasury is doing now is to implement some austerity measures to ensure that, one, they can cut wages, but not only that, but also to try and plug some of the leakages in the economy. Charles, do you think that this is something that will work, where even though it seemed to be having some negative impact on people, do you think this some of these measures will work to stabilize the economy?
I think so, because Kenya is also going through a similar problems like ours. Recently, the president said that they also spend about 70% of their tax revenue on wages. So the wage bill is also...
Is that really true? Well, we'll take that at some...
Yeah, so that is the report. that they spend about 70%, just as we also spend around that same figure on wages.
Yeah.
And so the budget deficit is huge. It is widening. Okay. So the government actually has decided that they need to cut down costs.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then plug loopholes.
Mm-hmm.
And the government proposed that the president said that he and then his
ministers
and ministers will cut down their salary by 20%.
Mm-hmm.
And then the MPs also try and do the same.
Mm.
Currently, the president of Kenya used to take about $14,000 per month. $20,000 cut will bring it to about $11,000. The MPs used to take about $10,000 a month, which rises to $220,000 per annum, $20,000. They've also decided to cut it, about 40%, actually they've cut it. And now instead of taking $10,000 a month, they are going to take about $6,300 a month, which actually brings you to about $75,000.
Those are very significant cuts.
Exactly.
very significant.
So if you look at, and they have about 146 MPs. So
that's
146,
a lot of
so if you do the calculation,
on that side
you realize that, yeah, I mean, it's a lot of cost savings. So we actually need discipline, okay, in our financial administration as a continent, because there's a lot of leakages
and there's
a lot of waste in the system. So if we are able to tackle this area, okay, we'll be able to save a lot of money to spend it on capital expenditure, because most of the time, more than 50% of the expenditure is on recurrent expenditure, paying salaries, allowances, bonuses, and other stuff. And you are left with small money for capital expenditure, road, energy, and other things. But these are the areas that actually ensure that the economy grows.
The productive areas.
Exactly. So if you starve that sector with money and you push all the money on recurrent expenditure, how do you expect your economy to grow? So I think that it's a good policy that they have decided to embark on. You keep it up. And I think in our also part of the Ghana, the president also said that he was also going to cut his salary by 10% and advise MPs to do the same. So we are expecting that maybe MPs will also try and see.
But Ben, do you think that this would be pushed through to the end? Because sometimes introducing all these things, the intentions are good, but seeing them through to the end has always been a challenge. Do you honestly think that Kenya, the government, the National Treasury will be able to push through this to the end to achieve the end result they are looking for?
I really do hope so, because it is a good thing. It's something that they need to do, because if a lot of what you spend on is all recurrent, you are not actually investing in the economy that you are managing. So I hope they can do that. As to whether they do it, I think we'll leave it for another day.
But it's quite significant, you know.
It is very significant.
Cutting costs between 20% and 40%. It's quite very significant.
They have put the measures in place. They are doing it. As to whether they will see it to the end, I really do hope that they are able to do it, so I can bring some sanity into
the
economy.
Economy.
Yes.
We Ghana has a similar challenge in terms of wastage, leakages, and I'm sure most of the countries on the continent as well. Do you think, is it a matter of the political will to really plug these holes, or is it just that people don't see that there are holes?
I believe people see their holes. I believe that they are trying to do something about it. I think it's a collective effort that needs to be put in place, because the government sitting at Flagstaff House alone cannot do much if the people themselves who are supposed to look into these things are not doing the thing. Because this thing about biometric
registration. You mean the, what do you call it? The wage.
The wage thing.
The biometric registration for public sector people,
exactly,
to eliminate their names, ghost names and all
those things. I have been in this country for years and we keep talking about ghost names and ghost names and ghost names and ghost names. I think governments have come and governments have gone, but they have all tried to solve this thing. I think that the political will is there, but putting it into action and getting the broad support of the people who are going to be affected by these things is the real issue. It's a real issue, because sometimes it is not the person who is at the top Flagstaff House,
mm-hmm,
but those who are at the district level,
the ones who are
those who are supervising those who are. Because if a teacher doesn't come to work for 3 days, 1 week, one month, and the supervisor does not see the need to report it and take action, and at the end of the period they come for their salaries and things, it's
nothing will change.
Nothing will change.
But the other issue is that, I mean, he said the political will is there. I don't think the political will is there. Why the political? Because most of the time, decisions are based on economic benefits or versus political benefits. It might be economically viable,
but not politically
exactly expedient. So exactly. So they always look at that, and that is why, you know, I believe I agree with this issue that leadership is a cause. The others are all effects. Okay. And Ben also made a mention of the fact that it is true that, I mean, you cannot always tackle it at the top there. It should also go to the down there. But pressure should come from the top
to ensure that those down there are delivering.
Do the thing. So we do have the political way. Our leaders know what to do.
Yes, that they won't do it.
But they always, I think that they put the politics ahead of economics, or they put the party ahead of the nation, and they always say that you know, this is national, you know, for the ordinary people. That's what they talk by their words, but their action, you already see that. I mean, it's either politics ahead of economic, or it's about the party ahead of the nation. So I think that the political will is not there, because we know the problems with this country, we know the solutions. What Dr. Bawumia said, I think that most of us are aware the problem that is facing this country.
No.
The solutions that he actually prescribed, I don't think that they are new. They came from heaven. You understand?
Yeah.
But I think it is good that he actually draws our attention, the attention of the leaders. But the political will should be there to make sure that the right thing is actually done.
Thank you. Ben, let's take a final break and then we'll come back to wrap up. Welcome back. So like you had a comment on what Charles was saying there.
No, actually I was saying that it's a good thing that Dr. Bawumia has given this lecture. I think that more economics in this country and more stakeholders of this country should come out.
To be bold enough.
Should be bold enough to
let us know what you think.
Exactly. Yeah. I think it is not one it's not about this government which is in power, but all of us collectively.
All of us.
We should come together and people should give lectures, statements, so that we know the issues that are out there and we all come and discuss it and find a solution and a way forward, because Ghana is for all of us and we need to move forward.
We need to move forward indeed. Well, I don't know if you have any final comments.
Yes, I think the only thing I have to say is that as a nation, we should not reject critics. The fact that the person is criticizing you does not mean that the person does not like you or what you are doing.
Okay. Actually, criticism provides an opportunity for you to know your weak point, so that you actually find ways of dealing with your weakness. So what Dr. Bawumia actually has put forward has actually pointed some weaknesses within the economy. And it, at the moment, it's up to the managers of the economy to take it on board and see what they can apply and then apply it, so that at the end of the day, it will be better for all of us.
So criticism is good. Criticism is good. So don't, but then don't criticize the messenger. It is a message, what they bring along, that we should be concerned about. For me, as I always say, and what this show wants to bring, is that not only do we promote trade within Ghana as a country, but also to promote trade among ourselves as a sub-region, as an African continent. Because if we don't do that, no one else will build our countries and our continents for us. I want to thank you, Benjamin and Charles, for being with us this morning. It's always a pleasure to have you, and I'm sure we'll be seeing more of you these days. Thank you and have a good day. We want to thank you once again for being with us this morning. This has been Business Africa Live on BTA, and I have been your host, Benjamin Afre. Have a good day. We'll see you same time tomorrow.